Welcome back to Rome Boys. On this episode, we're hanging with the saints today. Today's saint, Chris's favorite, St. Thomas Aquinas. Mm.
Absolutely.
The dumb ox.
Yeah.
His nickname.
Oh, yeah.
Not you.
I know. Really? I never heard that.
I just picture him like he's a big guy, right? So he's like in the background in the classroom and in the back row. And
me.
Doesn't say a whole lot. That says me too.
Okay. No, except
but
for that
at the
part,
same time,
that
he's
lot.
Super, no offense, and me too here, and super intelligent. And we're, yeah.
No.
He's like, whoo.
No, I'm not worried about that.
Yeah. And he's the big dumb ox, right? Yeah. Like, so he even looks big, you know? And he always sat in the back of the room. He was quiet. Not like the classroom, but like just in...
Yeah,
in
general,
yeah.
To observe everything.
And
in
then
the
one
back.
Time he spoke,
soaking
and
it all
he
in.
Just blew people's minds.
Ah, interesting. Well, let's read a little bit about him. Here's his bio. He is one of the greatest teachers of all time, and in particular, the medieval Catholic Church, honored with the titles of Doctor of the Church and Angelic Doctor. At 5, he was given to the Benedictine monastery at Monte Cassino in his parents' hopes that he would choose that way of life. In 1239, he was sent to Naples to complete his studies. It was here that he was first attracted to Aristotle's philosophy.
By 1243, Thomas abandoned his family's plans for him and joined the Dominicans, much to his mother's dismay. On her order, Thomas was captured by his brother and kept at home for over a year. Once free, he went to Paris and then to Cologne, where he finished his studies with Albert the Great. He held 2 professorships at Paris, lived in the court of Pope Urban IV, and directed the Dominican schools at Rome and Viterbo.
His greatest contribution to the Catholic Church is helping me to come into it.
part of it.
Well, that's a little selfish, but it's his writings. And, everything references it. The Catechism is based on it. I mean, honest to goodness.
Greatest theologian of all time, most people would argue.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, guys like a Stephen Hawking. He's like a smart person.
It's kind of crazy to think not one person is the magisterium, but goodness gracious, he's got a bulk of the material, in the Summa. The unity, harmony, and continuity of faith and reason, fidus et ratio, of revealed and natural human knowledge pervades his writing. That was deep. I'm going to read it again just so you guys get it. So the unity, harmony, and continuity of faith and reason is what basically reveals the natural human law, that's written on our heart.
Yeah, head and heart.
Yeah.
Connecting that.
He's got it figured out. He's so articulate in the way he writes. And for some people, it's a lot of words, but there's not a word that he's written that doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. Everything that he says has a particular point. And when you understand it, it just becomes so much more simple. Mm.
You just blew my mind.
Yeah, I want to make a comment to what you guys said a second ago, but I'll just continue here. So the Summa Theologiae, his last and unfortunately uncompleted work, isn't that crazy?
Mm-hmm. I thought I had everything in it.
Yeah, basically stacks to the ceiling when you...
Symmetrical book stacking, just like the Philadelphia Man's Turbulence of 1947.
You're right, no... human being would stack books like this.
Stack up the document. Deals with the whole of Catholic theology, so all of it. Mm-hmm. Yet it's an uncompleted work.
Right.
It probably touches on every point of Catholic theology.
Especially at that time.
He just didn't finish talking about every point.
Right. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, off the 1, 2, 3.
I wonder if that's kind of a prophetic little kind of detail that it's an unfinished work because Catholicism is an unfinished work.
Yeah.
It keeps going and
it's
going.
That's awesome. Like, that's a great, great point. he stopped work on it after celebrating Mass on December 6th, 1273. What date is that? The 6th. Oh, no, I was thinking...
The 8th is Immaculate Conception.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, that's...
And that's right. Nick's feast day.
Ah, it's close.
December 6th.
Yep, coming up. Yeah, we're recording here mid-November, yeah. Right? Yeah. 2021. So, yeah. So 1273, that was a long time ago.
Yeah.
Gosh. Yeah. When asked why he stopped writing, he replied, "I cannot go on. All that I have written seems to me like so much straw compared to what I have seen and what has been revealed to me."
Yeah, because he had a vision of heaven. Yeah, at that mass.
Wow. He died in 1274. So before I lose my thought, because you know I'm good at that. he was first attracted to Aristotle's philosophy, mm-hmm. which is, in a nutshell, I find so amazing. Aristotle said, "As the island of my knowledge grows, so does the shore of my ignorance." Mm.
You just blew my mind.
Right. So like as it gets bigger, it's just mm-hmm. I'm realizing how much I don't know mm-hmm. because of what I do know now. Yeah. And it's the opposite. I'm sorry, guys. I'm just going here.
No, this is your man, go for it. So go for
yeah,
it.
Yeah. It original sin was having the full knowledge of God, right? Mm-hmm. Not eating from the tree in the garden. Mm-hmm. The one thing that you can't do, what, why? So, well, obviously they were tempted to do so, but so that they could be like God, so that mm-hmm. they could have his knowledge. Then they realized that they were naked, right? All these things that they didn't know before, they consumed sin upon themselves, mm-hmm. just like we do in the Eucharist if we're not properly without grave sin and knowing what we're consuming, right?
We're not worthy! We're not worthy!
Paul says in Romans. So I find it very, very unique and awesome that he didn't complete his work, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So he's not all-knowing. He's not yeah. Jesus. He's not God.
Which he would be first to admit.
Yeah. He realizes that as he gets smarter, there's more he doesn't know, which right. speaks to the infinity of God, the vastness, mm-hmm. the omnipotence, the omniscience of God. And then he goes on to say that it wasn't his writings that actually was his most profound knowledge of God through faith and reason. So obviously he thought a lot, right?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
But scripture doesn't talk about intelligence as academia.
Sure.
And
or necessary for salvation.
Absolutely, right? Mm-hmm. What, and I've got chills because this is my man.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like I love St. Thomas Aquinas.
Blue, you're my boy!
Thank you, sir.
Because he's such a, he points to Jesus more than any other saint because it's so self-evident. It's mm-hmm. so self-revealing. My final point to the point of academia, everything that he wrote was straw compared to what he saw and what he experienced, mm-hmm. which is, Scripture says that wisdom only comes from experience. Hmm. And it's so, like the Mass says, go forth. Mm-hmm. Everything that we learn within the walls of the church, within RCIA, CCD, all of this headiness that we get out of the catechism and what people think we have to abide by, which is the law, you know, the Mass is the sacrifice of the new law, right? And I could go on, which Christ, through the ministry of the priest, offers himself through in an unbloody manner under the appearances of bread and wine. But so even the experience of the Mass, it's not about like did you get it, but it's about experiencing Jesus in no other way that you can anywhere else. That's actually Jesus there. That's an experience. All five senses are hit in the Mass. St. Thomas Aquinas does this, and guys, I'm just going on and on, but I get fired up about it. I love the fact that no matter who you are, it's the experience in your life that you can share. It's duplicable. It's duplicatable.
Whether you have an amazing intellect or not.
Yeah, mm-hmm. right. Mm-hmm.
What'd you say? Wisdom grows from experience, and experience yeah. grows from bad decisions.
Yeah, right. Amen. How many do we have at this table combined?
And like Matthew Kelly says, genius in Catholicism. That's why we need confession, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So that we can get right with God again.
Right, right. Yeah, Thomas, I mean, he reminds me, because I am not an intellect like him.
Whew, yeah,
you
yeah.
know, he reminds me how it's important to stay on the practical level and have your hands dirty and make sure theology and your faith is being really lived in the real world. Because mm-hmm. I've seen a lot of whether it be priests or even some friends that are theologians, and they get so into the intellect that they lose their faith. It's crazy. Yeah. You know, and they lose their
grounding. I would say it's the enemy of your faith.
It can be. It can be kind of scary. Right? I had a friend that like just studied his way out of Christianity. Yep. So we have to be careful. But and with Thomas Aquinas, he can definitely keep us on that road of having the balance. I mean, like he wrote the Eucharistic hymns on Tantum Ergo, and like he spent hours in front of our Lord in the Eucharist. Like we know him for his intellect, but really, what's all the other things? His humility, you know, his pastoral guidance as a Dominican. So those are things that sometimes get overlooked. I thought Dominican. Because he got left at the Benedictine Monastery.
That's right.
He's a great Dominican. The Dominicans love him. Yeah, and Catherine of Siena. And
I feel all embarrassed because I'm like, this is my guy. Point. You're right.
A little faux pas. No big deal.
Some miracles. St. Thomas Aquinas. They always harass me about saying miracles. So anyways, St. Thomas was not a cold intellect, but a great lover of our Lord and our Lady. See, again, that's the first line, and that's what is more important than actual the Summa, but important, that of course, is. And he was many times seen floating in ecstasy. He performed many miracles, duplicating one of our Lord's. When a poor woman was healed of an issue of blood by touching the fringe of his habit, when he lay dying, he asked that the Song of Solomon be read through to him from beginning to end. And on receiving the Blessed Sacrament, he said, I receive thee the price of my soul's redemption. For thy love I have studied, watched, and labored.
Mm-hmm.
What nice words to say as you're heading home.
I don't think I could think of something like that.
Yeah. Lord have mercy is what I'll be saying.
When the state comes in to survey our nursing homes, which we've just gone through this week, it's pretty intense, but they do observation, interview, and record review. So it's this legalistic way of making sure
that they got from Thomas.
Sounds
like it. I mean, yeah.
I sure hope so. I mean, yeah, if he said it, I'll do it.
There was on another occasion where St. Thomas was hanging out with his buddy, St. Bonaventure. You can imagine these guys just sitting around, all these saints, just kind of drinking coffee. You know, it's like,
cigar.
How high did you float today?
We're not doing that, guys. What's up?
So he was having a conversation with the two of them, and Bonaventure asked him, whatever he knew, he had most part learned from the book of the crucifix. So one day while he was in prayer, Jesus spoke to him from the crucifix, saying, well hast thou, I have to read this because I can't, well hast thou written to me, Thomas, what reward wouldst thou have? I'm so glad we don't talk like this.
Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth?
Wouldst thou have? What reward wouldst thou have?
You dropped your monocle.
Yeah. What's that? St. Thomas, when he lifted his head, he spoke with humility, I will have thyself. I will have thyself. I will have thyself.
Basically, all I need is Jesus.
Basically, I will have you.
Yeah.
Okay. So anywhere, basically, Jesus was asking, what reward would you have for writing about me?
Like Solomon.
I just want you.
Wisdom or riches. I just need you, Jesus.
I just need you. Just give me you.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah, it's awesome.
Just give me Jesus.
From the book of the crucifix?
Yes.
So basically he's saying that the crucifix is a story, a novel. It's not actually like there's not a book.
How many hours has he meditated upon the passion of Jesus to get to that point to say it's a book of, it's everything.
Just looking at the crucifix is a book.
So my personal, I know I told you a bunch of stuff that I like about St. Thomas Aquinas, but let me just add some personal spice to the matter. I'm a convert to Catholicism. And in College Station, Texas, home of Texas A&M University, and somebody's going to probably try to correct me on this, but they produce more priests than anywhere else in the United States out of Texas A&M.
One of the top.
Yeah.
Gotta say that.
Steubenville, I know that some of those guys are probably shaking their fist at me.
Wichita?
Wichita's strong. It's true. But I was in College Station, I learned about the Catholic faith while I was there. St. Thomas Aquinas Church is there. I came into the church at St. Thomas Aquinas Catholic Church and I had the Sacramento Grand Slam. But when I met who is now my wife, Melissa, I was driving a UPS truck, and I stopped in at a non-denominational bookstore, and I thought, you know, I was going to Central Baptist Church there, and I wanted to make sure that I was a good Christian counterpart, you know, and a friend, really. So I went into the store. I had a delivery there anyways. So I looked around, and there was a book called Becoming Friends. So I bought it because I thought, wow, I'd never met somebody like this person before, Melissa. First of all, a girl who's Catholic. I just never really knew somebody that I knew that they were Catholic. And she was awesome. She had only missed Mass one time in her life.
What?
No exaggeration. And I'm, 20-something years old, you know? Gosh, I'd missed lots of Sundays in my life. So I just thought, who is this person? I need to, you know, sharpen my own game here. Well, I went to my first Mass with her as a friend. In that book, though, it was not a Catholic book. But when I opened it up, it said, this includes some writings from people such as St. Thomas Aquinas. And I thought, huh, that's really kind of the first or second time I'd ever heard his name.
Mm-hmm.
Again, the book had it in there. Well, I took a went to Mass there. I took a class called Philosophy of Religion at Blinn College. And my professor gets up there with his khaki shorts and his tan socks and sandals and, you know, his nice feathered hair and big, thick glasses, like a professor would in a philosophy class. And he said, well, let me just give you full disclosure. I was raised Catholic, but I'm not a practicing Catholic anymore. We're going to be learning from all sorts of philosophers, such as Immanuel Kant and Siddhartha the Buddha and other people such as Saint Anselm and Saint Thomas Aquinas. And it was the last one he said, and I thought, there's that guy's name again. But then when he started presenting his information, I was blown away. So I started writing about his writings and how it had impacted my life and the reason and the faith and all of these things. So bookstore book, first time I ever went to Mass at St. Thomas Aquinas, and then my professor says it all at the same time. God was talking to me, and this is when I came into the church. So I give St. Thomas Aquinas a lot of credit for that. Well, fast forward, got married, went through RCIA. He's my patron saint. all of these things were happening. After we're married, we're driving away, Melissa and I, after the reception. And we're going on a cruise, and I was excited, and I forgot my wallet, and I had no idea where it was. I mean, all of these, you know, hundreds of people at our wedding because of Melissa's side of the family,
one of them stole it.
Melissa said, pray to St. Anthony that he helps you find it, and I was like, okay, St. Anthony, you know, I need your help.
Yeah.
So we weren't finding it. We pulled over on the side of the road because we were on our way out of town. Digging through the whole car because it had to be in our suitcases or somewhere, you know. And then I said, I ran around to the back of the car and I stood outside the trunk. And I said, St. Thomas Aquinas, will you please give me the memory and the intellect to find my wallet?
Yeah, yeah.
It was dark outside. The trunk popped. Melissa popped it from the inside. I reached into the car all the way to the back. And boom, my hand was on my wallet.
No way. Way. Yeah.
Not because I just all of a sudden knew where it was, but in the moment of me asking for his intercession, I don't even remember where it was when I grabbed it, by the way. It was in my hand. And I shut the trunk, jumped in, and I felt like my marriage was complete. Nice. You know, it was just so awesome. Like, all right, God, you approve. So here we go. Anyways, there's so many moving parts I could go on, but I'm not going to bore you with it.
But I don't want to bore you with those.
Thanks.
It's just really exciting to see a saint, you know, working in your life. Mm-hmm. So
awesome. Thanks
for
sharing.
That's crazy. Yeah. That's awesome. Well, thank y'all for joining us for Hanging with the Saints. Another round. St. Thomas Aquinas, pray for us.
Round like in the big dumb
he's the ox. Yeah, he's the ox. We got to recognize that. Don't forget to like and subscribe, share us with your friends, and in the meantime, I don't know.
We're going to do it?
Sure. Be real.
Be bold.
Be Catholic.
God bless.